Innovation in business is now about responsibility. And we're going to talk with the world's expert on it, Carol Sanford, right here today. Carol, welcome.
Thank you, but I'm not an expert, Stan. The reason I don't like the term expert is it sounds like you know more than other people. I guess if I had to say, what am I proficient at, or what do I help people think about? Well, it would be more like, how do you think more systemically, more about innovation, and you become the expert on your business.
Well, we're going to let you decide if she is an expert or not, because here's the website up on the screen, carolsanford.com. In and of itself is an education, but we're going to be talking an awful lot about The Responsible Entrepreneur. That's a book that you've written, and one of several that you've written, but it's the latest. Tell us about that.
The Responsible Entrepreneur I wrote because I heard people using the term entrepreneur in what I would say was a small way. To me, entrepreneurship is kind of a way you view the world. It's the way you take on the world. It really doesn't have as much to do with starting a business or the stage of a business as it does whether or not you really have intention to change the course of history. So I wanted bigger. In it, I wanted everybody thinking much more with personal agency, much more taking on something that was unique and distinctive about them, and making a bigger difference with their life.
Well, I guess the common meaning, or at least from the public standpoint of entrepreneur, is somebody who has an idea about a business and wants to go start it and then go make it happen and make lots of money.
Sure. I'm not negating those. I think there are levels at which one can go after entrepreneurship. I've seen entrepreneurial moms who decide they're really going to innovate in how they raise children, and they're not going to be raised the way they were. And it's really difficult because you tend to follow whatever pattern you were taught. So to me, entrepreneurs often break a pattern. So they may have an idea about a business, or they may have an idea about a nonprofit agency. And what they're doing is going after it with everything that's in them that's unique, which gives them the staying power. And hopefully, when you get to the idea of responsible entrepreneur, you're doing it in a way that also makes a difference and makes a better world for all of us.
Who defines responsible?
Well, you can go back to the foundation of the word, which means to be able to respond, literally to take into account. And so for me, I think an individual has to continually do that. I don't think there's a definition in a council that we go to, and if there is, it makes me nervous. What I want are people to ask the question, what effects am I having on everything that I touch and affect with all my decisions, with all my tasks, with all of my interventions? So who decides is really us as a human being. In fact, my next book is called The Responsible Human.
Oh. All right, I want to go to, I can't remember the gentleman's name. I think his name is Martin Shkreli from pharmaceuticals, who has a product that should cost $16.50 per pill, but instead he's selling it for 1,000% markup. It is an HIV/AIDS pill,
yeah, I've heard
as I
about
recall.
It.
I don't think he would probably fit in the responsible realm.
So I actually don't even go try and figure out that for people, because the important thing about what I do is I don't advocate and I don't judge others. I educate. So all of my interventions, if I had a chance to meet with him, I would not say, you bad person. I would say, could we sit down and just look at your business and look at, and I would educate him on how to think more systemically, how to, in fact, I can give you examples of where I've done that repeatedly with DuPont. Titanium dioxide, people, which comes out of mining, you pull down 90% of a mountain when I got there. And I didn't walk in and say, you bad people, you're taking down 90% of a mountain. I said, I'd like to teach you to have a business that can really be innovative, because it was a big commodity. So I started educating them about how to think about business. About a year, within a year, they were starting to find how it is they could innovate. We created a proprietary technology that gave them the lead, and they still have the lead in titanium dioxide business. But they also took down 90% less of a mountain, cleaned up all of the local villages, and I never advocated for any of that. I never judged to them. What I did is educate how to think, and they changed what they saw, which is what matters.
Well, I know you don't like the term expert, but I'll ask it anyway. Are you an efficiency expert?
No, I don't know anything about things like that. I don't go look at anything and tell people what to do. I educate them about how to think, and I say, now pick something that's driving you crazy. So if I were going to work on efficiency, what I would do to teach them to think about it is I would say, let's look at the difference between effectiveness and efficiency. So effectiveness means, are you producing the effect for the customers, for the community that you want to? Because if you start working on efficiency, efficiency, you may cut out the things that make you do it in less time, but it may be the very thing that needed to produce the effect for your customer that made them loyal to you. So I say everything that doesn't produce effectiveness is inefficient.
Okay, so we need to merge the two words together and be efficiency.
Now, I like effectiveness, and efficiency is just a step on the way.
All right. Let's go to some things that people are saying about it. Here's a New York Times bestselling author says, Carol says that this book is about being responsible, and it is, but it's also about being courageous. I dare you to read it and implement the bold, useful advice. Oh my gosh, what bold, useful advice did you
give?
Well,
Chris is such a wonderful human being. He has a book and a conference, all of which are about world domination. Now, what he means, and it's full of millennials, it's just full of people with spirit, full of people with great ideas, including Chris. And what he means is, I want you doing the thing that would actually really change something, that would really have an effect, rather than being a good entrepreneur which supports just your family and something local. Can you know that even when you're doing something locally, even something for you, if you think about it, it could have a big effect. And so when he doesn't write blurbs for people. He told me that, and I said, Chris, you're going to love this book. And I, as I said, I do know him. He read it, and he said, this is how you do world domination. So I don't know whether I would choose that term, but I say how you change the course of history and make it productive and whole for everyone who it touches.
Zuckerberg and the gang at Facebook, they definitely have changed history, wouldn't
you
say?
Absolutely. Google has changed history. Apple has changed history. Yes.
Do you think that they intended to do that?
Yes. I know for sure Steve Jobs is an Apple, because I taught at San Jose State in a master's program that we had lots of his folks coming in, and I went and hung out at Apple. It was very exciting. I got to hang out in the rooms with Steve Jobs. And the word continuously was, make a dent in the universe, make a dent in the universe. And if you ask Steve what he meant by that, he said, do something that will really stand for all, you know, for a long time, not necessarily all time. So he intended that. Google's the same way. Larry Page and everything we work on there, he says 10x. I want it to have a 10x return. And I want it to make a difference. And he learned this in Montessori schools. I want it to have that big a difference. And the 10x is not for Google. It's for the community or the customer or whoever it is you set out to do something. I don't know Zuckerberg personally, but I know the other two, and I can say with all intention they set out to do that.
All right, well, let's go to another quote about the book.
All right.
This is from Rebecca Henderson from Harvard, and she's got a long other title. She says this is a book for people who create enterprises that create good work in the world.
Mm-hmm.
So is it about a bunch of do-gooders?
No, in fact, do-good is too small. What Rebecca knows, she did case studies and looked at my work, and what she found was that it's a way you have a business that is effective and efficient. It stays in business a long time, but it does it in a way, it's the how. So for me, responsibility is not the what, it's the how. So if you learn to run a really good business, you would certainly run it as ethically as you could. You personally would, and most people would. You would run it with caring what the effects were, making good decisions. So responsibility is the how of it. And what she's actually talking about is that she often says also that I'm building the business of the 21st century and have been for 40 years, and people are catching up with me. And what that really means is so that humans are worked with in a whole way, but good is usually, well, like there's less bad, there's good, and then there's what makes the system whole and complete. So good is usually what humans think. It's insufficient to having a planet which is healthy and a society which is healthy.
I think that if you were to ask the general public in the United States, and it may be a function of media, I'm not sure, but that business is less bad rather than good.
Well, most people, I think, would say it's actually bad.
Well.
Yeah, and they would probably say responsibility is about less bad. I think that's true. You know what's really fun for me is I have never worked with a CEO that didn't want to really be responsible. Now, part of that is the people who bring me in, but I think that there's bigger intentions than people know how to do. So I often say, if you really spend time looking at what people are seeking to achieve, it has higher intentions. Even a CEO, a president of the United States, all those folks can't pull off as much as they wish they could, and we wish they could.
Right. Let's go back to Rebecca Henderson. She also says, she talks about an elite core of people that is emerging everywhere. Carol Sanford, an extremely experienced member of that movement, has written a book about it that puts leading figures, Steve Jobs, Oprah Winfrey, Richard Branson, Tesla founder Elon Musk, seventh generation founder Jeffrey Hollander, and more in context, and helps you realize you're in it with them. I just got to ask you this. How'd you get to play with all those people?
I've had a blessed life, to tell you the truth. And I've actually never worked with Oprah. She's the one that I didn't have any access to, but I have so much respect for her. I think that all my work has been by referral, and some of those were more in-depth interviews. A lot of them are the life I live working with them because I get to be inside of Google Innovation Labs. I think that the fun part of the world that I have is that people refer me to other people. And so I worked with Chad Holliday, chairman, CEO, and president of DuPont Corporation from the time he was very young. He just took on the chairmanship of Shell Oil and just announced a new transparency initiative.
We figured that in an oil business?
Yeah.
My goodness.
Make it completely transparent. He helped found the UN Global Compact, mm-hmm. and he did that out of work that showed up and we developed in DuPont, where we became transparent to the board of directors by bringing in people from all walks of life and gave them access to the company to interview, and they wrote reports to the board of directors. It was a funny little thing. It had no advocacy in it. It had only education. Here's what we found. And it changed what the board of directors thought about their role was in leading DuPont, because it made things transparent even to the board. I mean, you'd think they would know, but they didn't. They did not know. And so Chad and a couple of other folks convinced the board of DuPont and a couple other folks to found the UN Global Compact. And the only thing it took to get in was be transparent. So again, transparency in education changed far more than we know. Advocacy usually slows it down.
Well, I understand.
Yeah.
Out there right now, we know that a bunch of people are watching or saying, wow, I've got a great idea, and I think I could fit this. Well, let's just talk about the top five errors entrepreneurs make.
Well, let's take a couple to start with. One of the primary ones is that they tend to go copy how they're going to structure their business from businesses that have been around for a long time. So they put hierarchies in place from top to bottom, layers, way too many people, and they disconnect the people who are actually making product or delivering services from what the idea was behind the business. So this inability to have people have a personal connection forever is a really important area, and I spend a lot of time undoing it when I go into companies that are growing. Like, you know, Google's now getting a little older, it's starting to put in too much hierarchy, and the minute you do that, you kill personal agency in the people who are there. So to me, that's the number one error. The second thing that they tend to copy or they read and think is a good idea is they borrow behavioral science technologies. Those are things like incentives, rewards, recognition, because what they don't know is all of that research came from the study of rats. So if you manage rats, all that theory is just perfect. If you don't manage rats, it is inaccurate and it's the wrong way to manage. So not actually understanding how humans work is the second error. So let me at least give you a third one. It takes a little while to do all these. But the third one is that they don't understand they need to get in the lives of the people they're serving, not ask those people to tell them what they want. So the big three that you mentioned earlier, Facebook and Google, and then I mentioned Apple, some others, they don't do market research. They don't do customer feedback. Because first, if those people can give you that in research and in feedback, they can give it to everybody. So there's nothing differentiates you. Secondly, people are very bad at actually telling people what they want. Third, by the time it gets to you through some person who's done the survey and then amalgamated and then passed it to marketing, who passed it to some other people, it doesn't look anything like what the people said, who didn't actually say something that would generally be helpful. Marketing people tend to change it a lot, but even if they don't, it's so distant. So you've got to keep people who are actually delivering the service in touch immediately. Most of Google's ideas come from the people who are designing, talking with people, talking with customers. So let's at least take those three and they can get some more on the website.
Can an entrepreneur be a micromanager and be successful?
No. I assume by that you mean manage all the people below them? No. There's nobody in the world, even parents can't be good micromanagers and be a good parent.
I've noticed that.
Yeah. Because what really keeps people alive and responsible, and what we're trying to do when we manage them is control them. We're losing all the creativity and reflection they have on understanding the market. And so if you find yourself micromanaging, you have designed the wrong kind of work system. You have put in the management system that will destroy entrepreneurial energy, because you want everybody in the business thinking entrepreneurially. So stop that micromanaging, whoever you are.
Well, so then what a good manager does then is trust people.
Oh, much more than that, much more. And in some ways, managers go away. And the companies that I work with, even very large ones, we redesign work so that people are responding to the stakeholders to the business. So I help people establish something called promises beyond ableness. And promises beyond ableness are where people say, for this customer, like Apple did this all the time, for this customer group, college students who are really trying to create all sorts of media of all sorts, I want us as a group, he would say to his team, to promise to figure out how to do that. And different people would take on different parts of that promise. Actually, once you get that spirit and energy dedicated to somebody who's going to use it, you don't need managing anymore. You need people who can manage the promise getting delivered over time. I convert all the managers into something I call resources. Resource means to return people to themselves as the source, and it's their responsibility to build capability. So that's the number one thing. It's not just to trust them. You do have to do that, but you have to build capability to think bigger and bigger and bigger, and that's why I say I'm an expert in thinking. How do you educate people to think about the whole? I say build the mind of the CEO in everyone, not in just the top.
Let's talk about some of the types of entrepreneurs that you talk about in the book. The first one, if we can get to that, is, and these are the archetypes, the realizing entrepreneur, which you say is an industry game changer.
So let me first tell you why I came up with these archetypes, because that's really important to how this happens. I'm 1/16th Mohawk. I don't look like it, I don't have the bone structure, but my great-great-grandfather was an Iroquois Mohawk who came across the bottom of the United States during the transition to try and put natives in reservations. He taught my grandfather that in order to rebuild any community, any nation, you have to have these four roles playing out. They call them warrior, clown, hunter, and head man, and I say, or head woman. But you had to rebuild a community with those. So I've used those for years to teach organizations how to have everybody playing those roles. You're not one of those archetypes. You don it like a mantle, like Superman, like Wonder Woman. Mm-hmm. And you know that you get bigger and able to manage more when you're wearing that mantle. So I felt like that was a good way to provide leaders a way. If you're going to take on these big ideas I want you to take on, change the course of history, you got to have a cape. you got to have something that gives you that energy. And these were, I changed the names from warrior, clown, hunter, headman to the ones that we're going to talk about here. So the first one, as you said, realization. And that is to help people realize what it is that's going on in an industry. It's an industry game changer. So I use Steve Jobs plus a couple of ordinary folks. And Jobs did say, I want to change this industry, and then I want to change another one, and then I want to change. And this was when he was young, even before they fired him the first time. So I wrote stories because I was close to Apple early and about what I felt like really went on. And the new movie is just so far off of my experience of Steve Jobs. I feel like it's somebody who had a filter that they shouldn't have had on, because what he really was doing is he was tenacious in determining to change an industry. And what you have to do that is you have to perfect lives of people you serve. You have to have their lives become more extraordinary. That's how you design. Then you will change an industry, and as you notice, everybody will follow. So until you think about the industry as a whole, and I'm an impact investor. When I interview entrepreneurs, and I only do growth stage entrepreneurs, but I always ask them, how are you going to change this industry? And they say, well, I'll be happy if I can do just this little piece. I say, good luck. Because I'm not interested in people who don't really want a whole industry to move. Otherwise, you're one product, an alternative product, a good alternative product, but 99% of the industry continues to do what it does. So to me, you're not a responsible entrepreneur with that big a thinking.
What I'm hearing you is that you, Carol Sanford, are someone who helps people not get 100% out of themselves, but maybe 110%.
Well, I've never understood that metaphor. I know the intention of what you're talking about. The way I would say that is that they find out who they deeply really are. I call it finding their essence, finding their singularity. The minute you start to live from that, you become bigger. You fill more space because now you're you. You're not copying. You're not looking at some competitor. You're actually bringing the fullness of you, and it tends to quiet the personality that's been conditioned in life, what your parents told you to do, your teachers. And it lets some people call it the real you. To me, it's the essence that was born with you. And the minute it wakes up, it feels like a bigger and bigger because you're actually growing. So that 100% actually is more than it was before. And now it's more.
Okay. So in order to make you happy, does someone else, in order to be a responsible entrepreneur. Do they have to build something brand new, or can they just compete better at building something that someone else has already built?
Well, that's not even where you start. I mean, it's not about new or start. It's about starting out in the world and saying, what would make that more extraordinary? So if you look at, well, let me say Colgate-Palmolive, because I worked with them in South Africa during the transition out of apartheid. And so we could have said, well, should we do new products or should we do improvement of old products? We said, or Stelios Sesos, who was the general manager who led it, said, I want to build a great company, or excuse me, I want to build a great country while we build a great company. Now, I didn't have anything to do with product. But he said, now what does it take to do that? And they decided, well, and everybody in the business had a promise beyond ableness, including Isaac Mishiel, who ran a detergent tower. And he said, I want the children's oral health to be improved radically in Soweto and Alexandria Township. So in some ways you could say, well, that was improving, but the way he did it was he brought dentists in, he brought women who could sell the product, they became educators to teach it, and he tracked completely how they were doing. Now, they sold quite a bit of toothpaste and they sold quite a bit of mouth rinse. But what they did was took on the change of the life force of children and then eventually others in the community, and they just happened to use their business to pull it off.
Let's talk about the reconnection entrepreneur.
Yes.
It's about society.
Yeah, each of these, so there's another piece that to help you understand the four. I found that if people really want to make some big change, there were four doors or domains you could go through. One of them was through an industry, and that one's pretty hard all by itself. The second one was you could pick a social system, like justice system or taxing system or the economic system, and you could say, in the way I do work, I want to shift that system. Now, the funny thing is you have to already have been a leader in your industry pretty much to pull that off, or you have to be seen and perceived as having leadership of the industry. So one of the stories I tell in there is a young man named Kip Bartoff, and Kip wanted to change the fishing industry's relationship, the system that they had for fishing in relationship to massive sellers like Costco and Walmart. He formed co-ops, so he actually restructured something to form co-ops of all the people from the boat captain to the people who convert the fish and into sales and into Costco. So he changed the system by which people were willing to buy fish by putting a QR code on it. So somebody could put their phone up next to it and they could see what the mineral content, where it was caught, who the captain of the boat was. The next time anyone came into Costco and couldn't find a QR code, they were looking for somebody. They said, why don't all these others have QR codes on it? He changed the system by working on it. And he also gave all the fishermen and the people who were in that industry much a better platform to advertise on, because they had wild caught fish and you could tell exactly where it went.
Wow. Let's talk about the next one.
Yeah.
Reciprocity entrepreneur is a culture changer.
Yeah. Well, you know, a lot of what holds us in place from moving is the cultural paradigms and beliefs we hold. So that's how we get to racism, right? I mean, that's how we get to sexism. We have all these images of who people are, how the planet works. And the minute we're holding those, it's really difficult to view or to get change. Now, you can go advocate during a presidential election that certain cultural beliefs are not true. And what you do is escalate the differences. And people get into their boxes, right? So the people who work here as the reciprocity entrepreneur help us understand we're all in it together. Therefore, it's reciprocal. I tell one story in the book about one of my Google guys. He was just amazing. He's decided to transform our relationship to food on the planet and our beliefs about food and about the health of food and our relationship to food. It's amazing what he has done already in third world countries, even in the U.S., in terms of bringing research together where all these people have been in separate pockets working on it, and helped us understand our reciprocity with Earth and with supply systems. So that's what a reciprocity entrepreneur is. They change our beliefs and how it is we see that we're all in it together and dependent on one another.
You know, if I go to a global food company, well, like McDonald's. I know that I can go to McDonald's anywhere in the world and it's going to taste the same. And I suspect that's probably because of whatever they add to it.
Probably. I don't know.
And, you know, it's just a guess on my part.
Yeah.
But if I were to go, and I'm really kind of into eating natural foods.
Right.
Let's take sweet potatoes, something that I've heard in the past that you like too.
Yeah, yams,
sweet potatoes
but
have started to taste a little different to me. And I'm wondering, is it me or is it the way they're grown or...
So I actually don't know content of things like that. What is important to me out of what you just said, though, is that we work with businesses to understand what their uniqueness and distinctiveness is as a business, mm-hmm. but also any raw material they have. So we could be looking at sodium cyanide, which I've worked with, or we could be looking at yams that are grown in the ground. One farmer should be able, because of knowing the soil they have, knowing how it is that the essence of yam or sweet potato works, should be able to create increasingly unique and distinctive yams while making the soil healthier at the same time, while making the farmer healthier at the same time. So it may be, I think that maybe what's happening and what you're talking about is we move toward commodifying things. So all sweet potatoes or yams kind of get alike. And the minute they get commodified, they all go downhill from there because it's not differentiated.
Let's talk about the regenerative entrepreneur.
Yeah.
This is a governance a game changer, not government, governance.
Right, right. The reason I picked this term for this is I think that there is much can be done by looking at the governance agreements that we have, like what our Constitution says, what our regulatory says, what our courts say, and find out how it is you can enter in a way you can make something great happen. So Larry Page said, you know, normally what we do with the regulations we have around going public for a company is you have someone who knows all the rules. It's a very complicated thing. So you have Goldman Sachs, JP Morgan, they go in and they own it, they sell it to their friends, to their other connections, and so by the time it's gone public, all the same big players own it. And he said, I don't like that, but I actually understand something called the Dutch auction. And the Dutch auction is where people bid even down to the lowest level. I could own stock, and I did. I bought stock when it first went out. You bid on a level that you want, and it's protected from being able to throw you out and have only the top folks because they don't own the rights. That's taking a regulatory and making magic out of it, right? Really regenerating the concept that was in the regulatory process. They did the same thing on looking at the SEC, and it's why you and I can own our phone number and carry it around, because they said, I think I understand how that regulation works. So Larry Page took it on.
We have almost no time left, but I want to do this. You've got a lot on carolsanford.com, including the blog.
Yes.
Tell me about
that. I have blogs, podcasts. I blog, guest blog for so many different places. It has all of my speaking gigs, one of which is here in Seattle. I'm looking at the business of the future, which is what Rebecca Henderson from Harvard said that I was the best at. And I'll be speaking about that, and you can find out about those and sign up on my website, carolsanford.com.
And as we put it up on the screen, we just want everyone to know this is the kind of thing that you, with an idea, you can make it happen. Carol, take care. Thank you very much.
Oh, take risks. Thank you very much.